The right-hander Anderson will look back toward Campbell at second base. Now the 2-1. Swung on to the ball, hit well. This one out to deep left center. Back to the warning track. You can say goodnight to it. Guilmette put it between the big video board and the hitter's backdrop near the light standard. A two-run homer to put Texas on top here in the bottom of the first. The 1-2. Swung on to the ball, hit well out toward right. This with carry. Back to the warning track. Say goodnight to it. Downtown Porter Brown strikes again. His eighth home run of the season, drives it over the right field wall, and it's 3-0 Texas. The right-hander Drake Boggan with a pitch, swung on, ground ball, hit through the hole on the left side of base hit. Rounding third, being waved to the plate is Jared Thomas. He'll score. And Dylan Campbell now 2-for-2. 26th RBI of the year, an RBI single on the left side, extends the Texas lead to 4-0. But four runs have crossed the plate, and it's now a 7-0 Texas lead. There's a ball down the left field line off the bat of Jared Thomas. This will score two runs for sure. Porter Brown will stop at third base. Thomas, an opposite field RBI double to bring home two more runs, and it's 9-0 Longhorns. 3-2 swing and a miss, and Kobe Minchie ends his night with an exclamation point, his second strikeout as he gets Miller Lattisaw to end the inning. As the 0-1 pitch to Guilmette is swung on, and that is through on the left side as Meese couldn't handle it. In to score from third is Kennedy. Stopping at second is Powell. Guilmette drives it through, and now it's 12-0 Texas. 0-1 pitch, and that's hit, and it's tailing away. That is going to fall in, and it's going to go to the wall. It got past the diving center fielder, Logan Britt. Here's Thomas. He'll hold it third with a triple as the Longhorns get a couple more runs in, and Texas now leads it 14-0. One ball, two strikes the count. Here's the stretch from Charlie Hurling and the 1-2 pitch to Holden Rook. He hits it on the ground a short. Could be two. A flip to second for one. Barehanded flip. The relay to first in time. Flores to Daly to Constantine, and the inning's over. And that was some pretty defensive baseball put on by the Longhorns. 1-2 pitch, and that's hit on the screws out toward deep right center, and that is going to fall in for extra bases. Ballou will stop at second base, driving in two with a double. Max Ballou drives it into the corner, and the Longhorns now lead 20-0. The gap, and that is going to get beyond Ace Whitehead, and it's going to get Abilene Christian on the board, I do believe. Here's a throw back. Now O'Hara is going to relay it. Here comes the throw to the plate. The tag is there, and he's out. How about that? Wow. One ball, two strikes, two outs. This is a ground ball, and this one's going to go back behind second, up with it, a throw to first in time to get Nielsen, and the game is over. In seven innings, the Texas Longhorns, by mutual agreement of the coaches, win this one in seven innings. Nice 6-3 ground out to end the ballgame. In the seventh, no runs, no hits, and a man left. Final score in this one tonight. In seven innings, the Texas Longhorns 20, and the Abilene Christian Wildcats nothing.
You know, our producer Cameron Parker did an outstanding job of the edit there. If he had, and I'm thankful that he did not, if he included all the bases loaded walks and hit batters and stuff like that, we'd be bringing you the montage for the next 20 minutes. So, fortunately, that was not the case. What was the case was a 20-0 Texas win last night. In seven innings, and you heard me say by mutual agreement, that's the deal where it's not like with the Big 12 rule on getaway day on Sunday when if you're up by 10 or more after seven, the ball game is over. No, this is one of those deals in the non-conference where one team gets up by double digits and you start to get to the middle innings and it's not looking like the margin's going to drop below double digits, especially as it got to 14-0 and 15-0. And that's where there's communication between the two dugouts on behalf of the two head coaches. I don't think they're the ones doing it, but there's a conversation going, hey, you want to call this after 7, especially given the fact also it's a Wednesday night game and Abilene Christian has to get on a bus and head for the Valley. They got to go to Edinburgh. I think they were going as far as New Braunfels last night and then staying there, and then they were going on to UTRGV for a weekend WAC series. So, Longhorns handle their business. They win last night. Good morning, and welcome to Light the Tower here on the Horn, 104.9, 101.9, AM 1260. We're live, local, and digital on the Horn app and at hornfm.com. My name is Craig White. Glad to have you with us. Jeff Howe is here, and he was just here a second ago in the studio, and he just disappeared. Oh, okay. He's coming back in. Did he have to take a call, Cam Parker, our producer?
Yeah, there's some exciting stuff brewing in the 40 acres right now.
Yes,
so
there
I
is.
Think it may have to deal with that.
I didn't know if it was that or a bathroom run, you know, so what?
Wasn't
certain about that. But in any event, yeah, there's stuff going on that we'll get to. There's a lot to get to. Basketball, baseball, football, there's some things to get to as well. So, it's good. Meanwhile, Longhorns win that game last night. So they're now 27-12 and get ready for the Oklahoma Sooners. This is going to be another one of those deals where you have a team that comes in that is better than the record shows, and it is a rivalry series. So even at first blush, and I mentioned this on the broadcast with Ty Harrington last night, when you look at the standings and you see Texas sitting on the very top of the Big 12 standings and Oklahoma down at the bottom, you think, okay, and it's at home. Yeah, that's a must sweep, right? The normalcy of response and reaction to that would be to say, yeah. But we know that Texas and Oklahoma is not your normal Big 12 conference meeting in any sport, football or basketball or baseball or softball or golf or tennis or track and field, whatever it might be. It is that part of the rivalry as well. And I might also point out Oklahoma, they're not to desperate straits yet, but they're in enough trouble where there is a real sense of urgency for the Sooners to make sure they get on the stick to make the Big 12 Conference tournament. Because remember, only the top eight teams make the tournament in a nine-team baseball-playing league. Of course, Iowa State didn't play baseball. So in nine of the 10 teams that play baseball in the Big 12, next year it'll be 13 of the 14 who play. And Oklahoma's at 4-8. And so they're right now, they're a game and a half back of Baylor, and it might as well be 2.5 back because they lost the tiebreak to Baylor because they lost 2 out of 3 in Waco a couple of weeks ago. So crucial times there for Oklahoma as they come in. That's why it'll be a pretty intense weekend. So back in the house.
I had to take a phone call. Sorry.
I didn't know if it was that or to use your term, if you had to go pop pot.
No. Nope.
I didn't know if it was the one.
It was potty related activity, though, because at my house I lived in Buda, we're renting it out and I had a crapper issue that needed to get fixed over there.
Really?
Yeah, it's a simple fix, but, you know, I got to pay the bill and whatnot.
So yeah.
I had to step out and take it.
Okay. All right.
Everything's good.
So it was a pot pot issue, just not.
Just not mine. Not mine. Per se, it's mine.
Not your body. It's not the biology of your body, according as our friends at Total Men's would say.
We'll call that doo-doo adjacent issue, if you will.
Yeah.
I don't know what's going on in my rental property, but toilet's fixed.
So someone on the specs text line said, wanted to possibly see Cameron O'Bannon late in the game because of the blowout. Unfortunately, I understand the circumstances. Yeah, if the game had gone beyond 7 innings, you would have seen Cam O'Bannon out there because virtually everybody else practically got out there, just about, other than some pitchers. It's kind of like in the Major League Baseball All-Star game where they get everybody in, but not all pitchers get in into the game, and especially in the case of last night because it was the run rule thing that the coaches agreed upon there once it all got out of hand. So that's why, but to see Cade O'Hara out there and make a nice relay to the plate, by the way. Cam Constantine picked up his second hit ever as a collegian and as a Texas Longhorn. To see basically the entire infield swapped out and the only remaining guy that was in there was Rylan Galvan. And the only reason he stayed out there was because basically they were out of catchers because Garrett Guilmette had DH'd. Now, he got lifted for Preston Hoffert, who could have gone in behind the plate if they needed to do that, but clearly they weren't going to need to do that on that. So, anyway, there's some baseball stuff Somebody asked me, how long have I been at ARN? January of 17, so a little over 6 years. February 1st of 2017 was my, what does they say, start date of
start
employment.
Date, yeah.
Yeah, start date was February 1st of 2017. So just past the 6 year mark pretty recently there.
I had a conversation a couple of years ago with somebody that was trying to tell me at 24/7 that I needed to take all of my vacation that I had available. And I was like, well, you realize my start date goes back to when I started with 24/7 pre CBS acquisition. And I was here day one. So my accrued time starts August 1 of 2010. So if you want me to take all the vacation time I have available, I'll see you at Christmas.
So all of that got to flip over, to carry over?
I was like, I'll take my week and a half and I'll see you in about 10 days.
Okay.
Take all your vacation you have available. Well, how about no? How about I don't? Don't want to.
Okay. That's good.
Speaking
there.
It just reminded me of start dates and end dates. But no, good morning on the 40. You know, we're a week away from the draft, which that's the bulk of what I want to talk about in the Longhorn Notebook, because there was an ESPN ESPN.com article on Bijan this morning, and just want to get into Bijan and look at where he's projected to go, because I'm not in tomorrow, and we don't talk a ton of draft as it is.
Right.
So figured today would be a good day to do that. Now, obviously, we'll get into the Max Asemus visit, talk a little Texas basketball portal. Nothing really brewing in the football portal, Craig, because Texas right now, they're at 85. So they'd have to lose somebody to add somebody.
Yeah.
And you can't go over 85. When you got your full complement, you cannot be over 85 at any point in time.
At any point, yeah. No matter what.
They got to lose one to add one. And I'm sure they're going to lose somebody. I just can't tell you for sure who it is.
Yeah.
And I think one thing I will say, though, I keep this in mind about grad transfers. If you're a grad transfer, you can enter the portal whenever. There's no restrictions on when you can or can't enter the portal. So you could get maybe like to August, mm-hmm. and if you decide, well, you know, I've graduated or I'm graduating a semester, but I don't like where I'm on the depth chart, I'll just put my name in the portal and finish out.
Yeah.
You know, unless it's a situation, I mean, once you enter the portal, I think this is kind of the gift and the curse of the portal for players. The school has the option on whether to continue your financial aid or not.
That's correct.
Like, I believe Bear Alexander, when he went in from Georgia, it showed that his financial aid had been canceled.
Yeah.
We're showing it's canceled.
Yeah.
So he needs a home ASAP. By the way, he's on taking an official to USC this weekend. I don't think that should surprise anybody. But
Right.
It's a long way to say nothing going on, really. The football portal, basketball portal, we'll get to it and then talk some Bijan next segment.
Toward that end, on the Specs text line, somebody said, Jeff, you teased this man. Breaking news that he's on campus. I was hoping that he committed. I'm definitely more anxious about this basketball squad than I should be. Clearly, and for those who didn't hear, when Jeff was on the program that preceded ours, B&E, he was talking about Max Amos, the Oral Roberts University point guard in the portal and on campus to visit the University of Texas, dinner with the team last night, was at the ball game last night. There's Rodney Terry throughout the first pitch.
What a first pitch it was.
I love the shot that got tweeted out by Texas baseball. I mean, it was completely through the follow-through. Leg kick swung around. I mean, it looked almost like, you know, 1960-ish.
Little birdie told me RT spent some time this week working on that.
Yeah, okay.
Wanted to make sure he put his best foot forward. So.
Good point. That's a good idea. RT always prepared, so that's good. But, I mean, that's the news where it is right now, is that he's on campus and mm-hmm. that he is visiting. Yeah. And there's probably a good feeling. As he was here for the ball game last night, and they probably have a good feeling about the prospect of him ultimately deciding to transfer to Texas.
I think the big thing for Texas in this one, I think, where at least when I started hearing that things were on the Texas side starting to feel good, when he left Manhattan, still not committed anywhere after his official to K-State, because both those schools are offering pretty much the same deal. Like K-State, you look at Jerome Tang's roster, he's having to do the same thing second year in a row, basically do it from scratch all over again. You know, with Texas, where Texas loses Jabari Rice and Marcus Carr, K-State's losing Marquise Noel. So you have immediate playing time for a guard of Max Asemus's caliber. Craig, you watch enough college basketball. Am I out of line when I say if you put Max Asemus in the Big 12, he immediately comes into this league and is, you know, under consideration for Big 12 Player of the Year, honors candidate type guy from day one?
Well, I think he definitely has all the tools, the experience, the game to be that kind of thing. The only thing I'm sure that folks always would be quick to remind us of is about all of the excitement and the hype surrounding Tyrese Hunter when he first landed here, and it took a while for Tyrese to ramp into the deal. But I'm in complete agreement with you on what his game is and what his game can do for the University of Texas. Absolutely. Yeah. It has that kind of skill set, has that kind of moxie, the headiness, and the experience.
You give me a guy that averages for his career as a 21 point per game scorer, proven experience in the NCAA tournament, career 39% shooter from three, averages almost 3.5 rebounds a game for his career. So that means he tells you from the guard position he can rebound it fairly well. And then over 3 assists per game. So between he and if you get Tyrese Hunter back, that's you're in the running to have the best guard tandem in the Big 12.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree with you on all of that.
I would think U of H would have some consideration for that. Well, you know, adding LJ Cryer.
Yep.
And, you know, Texas hosted Jaden Nunn from VCU last week, and he's committed to Baylor. And we talk about Baylor, Jacoby Walters, a true freshman, and Jaden Nunn, that's a pretty good backcourt.
So yeah.
It's crazy, Craig, how this league, you know, so much roster turnover, yet the better teams in this league just reload and get after it the following year.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, absolutely. On the Specs text line at 337-3776, 512-337-3776. Our man CB says, RT's first pitch was certainly better than that of Travis Kelce. If you've seen the Travis Kelce first pitch.
Or Carl Lewis or Vincent.
Yeah. Fitty wasn't real good.
Carl Lewis might be the worst because I would expect one of the greatest athletes of our time to look more athletic than he did throwing that first pitch.
Exceeded only by his singing of the national anthem.
Well, I'll give him a pass on that because, I mean.
That was horrible.
That was awful. I mean, if you go back and look at that, like when Derek Coleman's like laughing, he's trying to hold it back, and then he can't at some point.
Oh,
like it was,
gosh, that was awful.
It was brutal.
Purple Buffalo's daddy weighing in, Jeff, this morning, said, my fellow Gerald residency, Kobe Minchie looked good. He said, go Cougs. He did say residency. He didn't say anything about graduate.
Good, because Kobe Minchie and his family have enough sense about them not to put their son through that education system in Gerald ISD.
He's going through the University of Texas education system right now and doing quite well. And it was a designated start, went 3 innings, and guys went had a little bit of trouble in the third, and that we speculated about this before the top of the third started, because remember the Longhorns were at bat for well in excess of 20 minutes because they scored 8 in that inning, and there were 6 walks and a hit batter from Abilene Christian pitching at that time. So it was a long delay, and then he had a little bit of struggle, but he worked around it and still did not allow a run in the inning.
You know the ebbs and flows of a college baseball season, Craig. Everybody was due for a midweeker like this.
Yeah.
Where just like at some point you're like, all right, let's just speed this thing along. Let's wrap it up.
And I honestly did not think that was going to happen last night. Abilene Christian went in at 24-11, had an RPI like with Kansas State, not that far behind Texas State and some others. They'd had some respectable performances, but the pitching really struggled last night. And then the Longhorns did an excellent job defensively and also what they did. So, yeah, it was one that got away pretty quickly there. Somebody said the pitch was not on par with W. That's President Bush's pitch, encumbered by a protective vest.
Well, that might be the most impactful first pitch in the history of baseball. So.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a meaningful first pitch.
Yeah. Let's see. Said, don't worry, guys, we won't bring up Cam's roster slip-up yesterday.
I think it meant rooster slip up. But yeah.
And then somebody else texted in, and I had originally thought I might had saved this story for an inconceivable. We've got plenty to get to on inconceivable today, including we've got more alligator activity, except this time it's alligator activity at my annual vacation spot.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. At a store that I frequented several times. we'll get to that. But anyway,
we had the story, Cam and I did the story yesterday about a bear breaking into a car and drinking 69 cans of soda. It's pounding some Orange Crush.
There you go.
We decided instead of Cocaine Bear, that's Diabetes Bear, which would not make near the blockbuster movie that Cocaine Bear
has. Yeah, Elizabeth Banks might not be up for that one there. Statement from the Oakland A's. This doesn't surprise anybody. There's been wink, wink, nudge, nudge for some time that Oakland is going to cast a longing look toward Las Vegas and see if they could get a brand new ballpark. And the statement that they released this morning said, quote, "The A's have signed a binding agreement to purchase land for a future ballpark in Las Vegas. We realize this is a difficult day for our Oakland fans and community. For more than 20 years, the A's have focused on securing a new home for the club and have invested unprecedented time and resources for the past 6 years to build a ballpark in Oakland. Even with support from fans, leaders at the city, county, and state level, and throughout the broader community, the process to build a new ballpark in Oakland has made little forward progress for some time. We have made a strong and sincere effort to stay here. We recognize that this is very hard to hear. We're disappointed that we have been unable to achieve our shared vision of a waterfront ballpark. As we shift our focus to Vegas, we will continue to share details about next steps." No surprise there. The A's are
so in the span of a few years, Oakland has gone from hosting three big three professional sports franchises to now they'll have zero.
Yeah.
They lost the Raiders to Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
The Warriors play in San Francisco now.
Mm-hmm.
And now the A's are leaving.
Yeah.
It's a shame.
I mean, if you wanted to be cheeky, you could say, and John in the Bay can weigh in on this, but in fact, he just did. He said the A's are finally leaving of Oakland. Of course, they still may have to play three more seasons in that god-awful stadium. My point was going to be the cheeky might say, have you been in Oakland lately? You know, I heard it described one time as Newark on the Bay, the way that it is. And so, of course, Newark has an NHL team.
Well, it's, yeah, the Prudential Center.
Yeah, that's where the Devils play.
You know, when we went on that Cal trip a couple of years ago,
yep.
I stayed in Oakland, and it just didn't do a whole lot for me.
I have been a person who has never really – here's somebody who said, I was in Oakland last October, and the city of Oakland is rough looking. Yeah.
So it was a little more industrial, I guess, might be. I don't know if that's the right word, than I was expecting.
Yeah. Let me say this. This will take it back to 2015, the year that when Karen Aston was coaching the Texas women's team, they made their first Sweet 16 run under. So in order to do that, they had to win two games in Cal. They beat Western Kentucky in the first round, and then they beat Cal, the 4 seed, and Texas is a 5 seed. They beat them in the second round there at Haas Pavilion. On the off day in between the two games, the first round and the second round game, I asked somebody where I could, if there was a nearby coffee shop. I asked the hotel, and they said, there's a Starbucks right around the corner. If you go down and take a left and blah, blah, blah. Well, they gave me the wrong direction, or I went out of the hotel the wrong way, but mm-hmm. I turned the wrong direction. All of a sudden, I'm walking, and all of a sudden, I look around, I thought, I really don't want to be in this part of town. This is not good. I felt a little uneasy and was able to kind of wriggle my way back out of it. So it's been tough. And as John in the Bay points out, as a Bay Area resident, the A's never really wanted to be here, and the city never wanted to pay the bill. It was a 20-year dance. That they did, you know, and Charlie Finley moved them there in 1968 from Kansas
yep.
City. Kansas City is a great sports town and a great baseball town, but he wouldn't put any money in the club to make them a winner. And so the folks Got really disenchanted then, so he winds up moving. And then, of course, Major League Baseball turned right around and granted an expansion franchise to Kansas City, and the Royals have done fine there ever since. But, yeah, it's been a rough go there in Oakland, even when they were winning the three-peat of the World Championship, 72 through 74. They struggled at times with attendance and certainly over the years. And then, of course, lately as the team has been non-competitive, as it has been gutted there.
As tends to happen with the swinging A's.
Yeah. Yeah. So they were the Philadelphia A's under the direction and later ownership with Connie Mack, starting in the late 1800s, early 1900s, all the way up to 1954. And then they moved to Kansas City, and they were there, I guess, from 55 through 67, and then to Oakland. But now it looks like they're going to be headed for Las Vegas. And somebody else said, I remember my wife's from Oakland. Problems there forever. Nice hotels by Jack London Square, but no real advancement. Always fits and starts as they get terrible support. The A's get terrible support. They should leave. So anyway. Somebody said Oakland's more of a big neighborhood than a city. That's one good place. I said the Newark Airport is ugly. Yes, it is. You've been to the Newark International Airport.
I've never
airport.
Been to Newark.
Oh, you're missing out.
Only East Coast airport I've been to is LaGuardia. That's in that part of the country.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. All right.
Yeah, I'll take y'all's word for it.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you can take a word for it.
I still can get over the possum story in the Oakland A's.
Yeah, visiting radio booth. The possum that's made a home in there, and so they've had to move visiting radio broadcast into another area, right?
Yeah, because apparently I believe the Angels were in there earlier either this season or last season, and during the game they look over and there's a possum crawling out of the woodworks.
Yeah. Yeah.
Any live animals in your broadcasting days you've seen in the booth, Greg?
Lots of roaches and bugs at different places. Yeah.
Squirrels, raccoons, something like that?
Not in the booth. Not in the booth. And as Robert and Getting says, well, I reckon they can leave the possum alone. Yeah.
Wasn't there a raccoon at Dish Falk a few years ago? Am I remembering that right?
There was a possum.
Was a possum?
Yeah. Might have been a raccoon, too, but I know there was a possum running along the outfield wall.
I seem to remember an incident involving a raccoon. Maybe I'm just misremembering that.
May have been. I know there was a possum. I remember that. So, yeah. Animals like stadiums.
Spacious. A lot of room to roam. A lot of places to hide.
Yes. And
you can find you some food stuff.
Exactly.
Yeah.
They like athletes. I'll tell you what, I've seen rats in Oklahoma City at the Bricktown Ballpark.
Plenty of places to do your business, if you will.
I mean,
it's like heaven for wild game.
Yeah. I thought you were gonna say Gerald. For a minute,
that is the toilet of Texas.
It's not the toilet of Texas. And by the way, I meant to do this yesterday. I was going to send this to you, and I didn't do this, and I should have. But I did not send this to you. And as folks know, I was out yesterday, and I went to took the opportunity. I was up in Waco. And I went to up to Waco to moderate a panel discussion with Hall of Fame coaches. By the way, Tim Buchanan at Aledo said to tell you hi. He's got some Florence, Texas background.
Yes, Buck, good people.
I thought I'd taken a picture of this. Maybe I didn't. But there was I needed to grab a cup of coffee when I left the house.
Tell me you stopped in Gerald.
I stopped at the McDonald's in Gerald. And
are you okay?
I'm fine.
Were you vaccinated afterwards?
No, it went just fine.
Okay. I've made many a stops at the Gerald, the little gas station on the right side. It's a nice.
I want to make sure. Make sure you get your shots before you roam through that part of Williamson County.
Jeff conveniently glosses over the buildup. The business buildup that has taken place in Gerald that has outpaced your hometown.
That's not true Gerald people though that are building that stuff. It's outsiders.
But it's still for the community.
Well,
and you still have that. There's a nice Dairy Queen there.
But you still gotta get the the people that were born and raised in Gerald to understand about the fancy eating places and things like indoor plumbing and how to wash your hands and sanitary conditions. And
So he said, come on, Jeff. The toilet of Texas is Houston. Gerald is just the urinal.
I see that coming from a DFW area code.
Somebody else said, if Jeff keeps talking about Gerald like that, they're going to build another loop around Florence.
Keeps the Gerald riffraff out, I'm all for.
Oh, gosh. Hey, somebody said, hey, we have New York City-sized rats at the ballpark in Oklahoma City. I've seen them. They are there.
I've seen them.
I have seen them. I have.
Of course, rodents can occupy spaces in Gerald. We have the rat pee gym as a perfect example of how rats or vermin can occupy a building.
Somebody said, Canyon Lake is my Gerald. It's horrible. See, everybody has said, you know, as my dad so eloquently put it many years ago, every man has his own sack of rocks to tote. So, and meaning your own burdens, your own responsibilities, your own guilt, your own pleasures, and your own preferences and aggravations.
It's not my fault. Everybody that lives in Gerald is somewhere along in their family tree. Someone made a horrible decision to settle there. So that's not my fault. Don't blame that on me.
People are still settling there and are continuing to settle there, and it's growing.
And it's unfortunate. Coming, you got outsiders mixing with the locals, and it's a melting pot that's got some very unusual ingredients to it.
This is a definite dead end discussion. All right, when we come back,
y'all want me to talk about Kevin Garnett and Tim Duncan again?
There we go.
I'm gonna stay on Gerald.
There we go. All right, we're going to transition into the Longhorn Notebook. We'll do that when we come back here on Light the Tower on the Horn, 104.9, 101.9 AM 1260. We're live, local, and digital on the Horn app and at hornfm.com. I know one thing, you don't have to grip your wallet that hard if you are dealing with Tom McKay and Audiovisual Consultations about a home entertainment setup. Everything costs money, but he is very competitive with his pricing for that specific element that you're wanting to add to your home, whether you're talking about your den, your man cave, your family room, living room, outside patio, bedroom, whatever it might be. Tom and his staff have the equipment, the knowledge, the expertise to help you set it up the way you want. You don't have to worry about going out into the big box stores to shop for that 75-inch HD TV, or not to mention the mounting and the equipment, the bracketing, all of that kind of stuff. Tom and his staff handle all of that, and they can do it and also set it up where all your streaming devices can come right in and be comfortable with you. They have the latest equipment, not only in HD TVs, but the Sonos sound systems as well. Check them out on the web at avconsultations.com. You know, Tom's wound up watching those Dallas Stars in the hockey playoffs, but he'll make time for you. And you can give him a call at 512-255-8678. Let Tom McKay and Audiovisual Consultations help you realize the home entertainment system of your dreams. We're just jamming along here on a Thursday on Light the Tower on the Horn. Jeff will be out tomorrow. Appreciate Jeff and Cam holding things down yesterday when I was out. Gene Watson will be with us for our weekly visit tomorrow on the program, talk Major League Baseball, the assistant general manager of the Kansas City Royals. Get his thoughts on that Max Scherzer thing and the stickiness, the substance, the glove, and the hand. The umpire said it was so prolific that his fingers were sticking together when Scherzer was saying, no, it's just rosin. That's all it is. And this announcement about the A's planning to move to Vegas. So we'll talk to Major League Baseball and those Texas Rangers who have been playing really well. So we'll visit with him tomorrow on the program. Right now, it's time for a Longhorn Notebook.
Jeff Howe's Longhorn Notebook.
Which direction are we?
Yeah, we're going to talk NFL draft.
Yeah.
And there's an ESPN.com story today on Bijan, and I won't get into it, but there was one line in there that kind of just jumped out at me, and it was something along the lines of, he's a generational back for the wrong generation. And I think that depends on how you look at it. Wrong in terms of how the NFL values the running back position? Yeah, because if this was 15 years ago, Bijan would be in the mix for the number one overall pick because running backs just were valued differently at that point. But in terms of how he fits in today's NFL, he's the perfect fit at running back for today's NFL. When you look at all the ways he can impact the football game, he can fit into any scheme, whether you're zone schemes, gap schemes, whatever predominant scheme you like to feature on the ground, he can do that. We've seen him be a pass blocker. We've seen him catch the ball out of the backfield. We've seen him line up at various wide receiver positions. He can line up out wide. You can put him in the slot. He's going to walk in day one and be in the discussion to have the best hands on your team. So in terms of the modern day NFL running back, absolutely 100% he fits in with this generation and what you need to do to succeed in today's NFL. What's interesting is you look at his draft projections, and I'm looking at the latest two mocks from CBS Sports. One was put out yesterday by Ryan Wilson, and one was published today by Chris Trapasso. The Ryan Wilson mock draft has Bijan going where I think a lot of people have mocked him, 27 to the Bills.
Yeah.
Which then that brings in the Cowboys discussion, and we can certainly go down that road if you gentlemen want to. But Chris Trapasso released a mock draft today, guys, that has Bijan Robinson going 8th overall to the Atlanta Falcons.
Yeah.
And the basis of that ESPN article, a lot of it revolves around the Philadelphia Eagles.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at the Eagles, they got two picks in the first round. They've got number 30 and number 10. And, you know, the Eagles, is it fair to say, Craig, running back is probably the one position that they really need to address?
Yeah, that's a neat area. Uh-huh. Even for a defending NFC champion. Uh-huh.
If you're the Eagles and you look at your needs, you look at your roster, and you're one piece away, you're legitimately one piece away from getting over the top and winning a world championship, that's when I think it's okay to take a running back really high in the first round. Because regardless of that money you're going to pay Bijan, and I think you've got to look at the whole body of work with Bijan too, the character and everything you're going to get from him. It's not like he's a guy. He doesn't strike me as a guy that's going to get like 2 years into this deal and then want to renegotiate. Like he's going to be paid fairly according to the rookie wage scale and play out that rookie contract. Well, if you're the Eagles and let's say you exercise the option, chances are you're going to get the five best years of Bijan Robinson's career.
Mm-hmm.
Most likely. So if you're one, and my thing is, when you're the Eagles, all I kept thinking about as I was reading the story, and it was centered around the Eagles, and everybody knows how much I hate the Eagles, so it kind of pains me to project, to talk about Bijan and the Eagles in the slide. I kept thinking about the Bill Parcells line from that old NFL Films video, like, hey, this is why you lift all them weights. This is why you do all that stuff. This is why you acquire all that draft capital. This is why you make all those trades, is to put yourself in a position to make a move like this. And if running back is the one position that they really need to address, you think Bijan is the piece that puts you over the top, then take him at 10. Because guess what? He's not going to be there at 30,
nope.
And it's going to cost you way more draft capital to move up to go get him in the late teens or early 20s where you would need to move up to go get him. Because I guarantee you, like, when you look at realistic places where he can start coming off the board, and for me, like, again, the Chargers at 21 is the place where I've kind of looked at, is the point where you can start to maybe see him coming off the board. I think maybe even Detroit at 18. If it's the Eagles specifically and you're trying to move back up, I think the Bills are in the same boat too, because I think you can argue that the Bills are a dynamic running back away from getting over the top.
Yep.
And winning a Super Bowl, or at least getting there and you know, take your chances when you get there. If they're trying to move up, if I'm Detroit or Seattle, Tampa at 19, Seattle at 20, Chargers at 21, and I've got Buffalo or the Eagles trying to move up to my spot, I know who they're moving up to get. And yeah, I'm going to milk all the draft capital I can out of that. Like, yeah, give me your one, give me 30 or give me 27, give me your three this year and the two next year, and you can move up and have this. And is a team going to be willing to do that? Because that's a lot of draft capital to give up.
So, and basically, just to reiterate for hopeful or long-suffering Dallas Cowboys fans, short of making a trade to move well up in the pecking order, you're not going to get Bijan Robinson. All of that stuff that we saw for a while, it might be there at, you know, at 26, all that kind of stuff. No.
I think I've heard a lot of Cowboys draft people have the discussion about Bijan.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, I think this is all moot. I think you guys are wasting breath, because I don't think – look, if he's there at 26 – as a Cowboys fan, that's the scenario where I would not have a problem with them taking Bijan Robinson, because they do have some other needs.
You're right.
Tight end is a need.
Yep.
You need to start to rebuild that offensive line. You've got other needs. But if you haven't made any moves and you just let the board fall to you and he's there at 26.
Yeah, obviously.
I'd take him in a heartbeat.
Yeah, but he's not going to be there. He is not going to be there at 26.
We've seen stranger things happen. I don't think so either, Craig, but we've seen stranger things happen.
Normally, when you see something like that happen, when there's been that precipitous a drop, it's because they've discovered something about the prospect, something internal, something away from the field, and everybody knows, you know, what this guy is made of, not only as a football player, but as a human being.
I'll disagree with you on I think that's almost a case-by-case basis, because, like, you go back to Aaron Rodgers, right? Once he fell, I think – I forget the exact order of that draft. Once he fell, I think it was Cleveland at 5. Once he got past there, maybe it was Cleveland or Tampa at 5. Once he got past there, you didn't really get to anybody before Green Bay that needed a quarterback. Everybody either had high-priced quarterbacks, they had young quarterbacks on rookie deals, mm-hmm. or they had a situation where they just signed a veteran because you had a head coach who might be coaching for his job the following year and didn't need to take a rookie quarterback, or you had an entrenched starter, and with before the rookie wage scale, it wouldn't make any sense to spend a first-round contract on a quarterback.
I totally agree with all of that. Here's where I would say that differs. I think quarterback is the one position that's the outlier about that, because folks are, and we're seeing it happen again, folks are consistently draft people, analysts, and media, but mainly draft people are looking for what's wrong at this point in the deal. That whole business with Brady Quinn and what he was saying about C.J. Stroud, it's ridiculous. If you have followed that lately, Ryan Clark just lightsabered Brady Quinn for what he was saying about C.J. Stroud for, quote-unquote, standing up the Mannings. You're stiffing the Mannings, not showing up from there when he let him know he was not going to be coming. That's somebody fishing for something at that point. And I think that sort of fishing happens with quarterbacks far more than any other position.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. But you know, with Bijan, I mean, there's not really a position group either, Craig, that you look at and say, okay, there's going to be a run on this certain position where teams feel the need to move up. I think this is a pretty deep draft where, if you're Dallas or Buffalo, Cincinnati at 28, the Saints at 29, I think you can hang back and get the guy.
I agree.
Get somebody that's pretty high up on your board. So I'm with you in terms of, I don't think Bijan drops to 26, because I don't see there being that much vibe. Now, look, we could see it totally change. I don't get the vibe that there's going to be a ton of volatility in this draft. Maybe I'm reading it wrong. I just don't see this being one of those drafts where you see just a ton of movement in the first round.
No, I agree with you there. And folks can, to your point, fill their need areas, or at least address some of the need areas, without having to make a gigantic move up or down. The ones who have made the moves clearly are doing it, like Carolina.
with one guy in mind. And so
yeah.
with that being the case, you understand that. But I think everybody else is just going to wait and see best available guy on the board as it falls to them.
I don't think it's the running back production that has people nervous about taking it back in the first round. I think there's two things that really compound things for Bijan. One is, I think you look at the character issues Zeke Elliott had early in his career, where there were people telling the Cowboys, he's talented enough to go this high. You probably want to think really hard before you take this guy this high.
That's correct.
And the Cowboys found that out when he had that long suspension that probably cost him a playoff spot and then wanted to renegotiate the contract, and then you got into that contract from hell that you just now were able to get out from under. And then if Saquon Barkley doesn't have an injury, because I think we've seen pre-injury and post-injury, Saquon Barkley's pretty damn good.
Yep.
So I think had you not had those two instances, I mean, Christian McCaffrey was a high pick and the 49ers gave up stuff to go get him. Craig, you watch probably more NFC West football than anybody I know. I think that ended up being a pretty good fit, Christian McCaffrey with the Niners.
Yep.
So Bijan, without question, is talented enough to go in the first round. But if I'm the Eagles, if I'm their front office, I think really hard about taking him at 10 because I think it's going to cost you way too much to move up from 30, 10 or so spots you would need to move up to go get him. I just take him at 10 and say, he's good enough and we feel like this is the piece that puts us over the top to help us win a Super Bowl.
That I agree with. No doubt about it. All right. Coming up next, we'll have Inconceivable. Jeff's going to like this one because there's a good animal compliment in this.
Is it animal doing people type things?
There's one thing that's
because I had a blast with bears drinking soda yesterday.
Yeah, it's almost like that. And there's another wrinkle into that we're going to get to as well.
Cam and I had fun with that yesterday. A bear like getting an orange crush and just popping the top, and he's got his little comic book just kind of sitting propped up against the car.
Was it just a generic orange soda, or was it an actual orange crush?
The story said orange crush specifically.
Because that's my all-time favorite soft drink.
Yeah. Orange Crush specifically.
Yeah.
But apparently the bear left the scene when they found a couple of cans of diet soda open.
Yeah.
And apparently that's when he had had enough.
Yeah.
It was on the diet soda.
It was like, not for me. See, bear and I are thinking on the same.
Who do you know that's a huge Diet Coke drinker? Is it Schoening that's a huge Diet Coke
And Roger
drinker?
Wallace.
Roger is too. Okay. I thought Roger was Coke Zero for some reason. But.
If that is all that's available.
Well, Roger's a big Diet Coke guy.
He's
a Diet Coke P1. So
he is. He and Schoening both. They're both big. They'll.
Does Bill just crush them during a broadcast?
Yep. Roger too.
Really?
Yep. Mm-hmm. If it's available. Okay. If it's available. But Schoening would just slam them down. I was like, throw all that carbonation and that syrup on your vocal cords and you'd do that. But he, undaunted, would go forward, you know.
He's been doing it at that level that long for a reason.
Yeah, for a reason, absolutely. All right, we'll continue to light the Tower on the Horn, 104.9, 101.9, AM 1260. We're live, local, and digital on the Horn app and at hornfm.com. You know, you've heard me tell you about John Hardy and his great people at Divided Sky Roofing and Solar and how we kind of could be transitioning into those tough weeks where you have some severe storms that could do damage to your roof. And if you have worries about your roof, you can have John and the staff come out and assess it, give you a free and honest assessment on that. They will do all that. They're the people we trust when it comes to roofs. They're also the people that we trust when it comes to solar. They are way ahead of the curve on so many others, and a 15-minute phone call with Divided Sky can get you all the information you're interested in with regard to solar. Not only do they handle replacing those roofs with those Timberline solar shingles, maybe you're a customer who's had solar for a time, solar panels, different kinds of things, but you're not getting your full money's worth out of that. That's where those batteries can make a difference. And they also are your licensed, contracted guy that can handle batteries and solar work. Give them a call at 512-995-ROOF. That's 512-995-ROOF. They'll tell you more about it. It's TEC license number 37397. When you're talking about Generac generators, backup batteries, solar to modernize your solar home, check them out at DividedSkyAustin.com. Yeah, well, we've got
shout out to
offers.
The Purple Cups in the break room, by the way.
Yeah.
Still going hard.
Official colors of, you know, Florence.
Yeah, ours is a little darker purple than that. This is more like a K-State purple.
Yeah, it is. It's almost lavender.
Mm-hmm.
It is.
The Florence purple is more like a TCU purple. It's a darker shade.
Okay. I got several things to get to.
Several, huh?
First of all, is a submission from my wife who wanted specifically you to see this. This was on Instagram. You still have a rabbit, right?
Yeah.
How's a rabbit doing?
I may post an Instagram video of my daughter walking the rabbit with a harness and leash the other day in the yard.
Okay. So here's the next step for Charlotte, since she's already got. What's your rabbit's name?
Parsley.
Parsley on a leash and walking. How about the rabbit jumping obstacles? That's somebody on Instagram there. That's just walking around. The rabbit's jumping obstacles.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. Just jumping all kinds of things. So that's the next step.
Good to know.
Yeah. So there's that. That's important. Secondly, This was something my brother sent to me because this went straight to my situation of going where I go on vacation every year. And folks know I go to the coast of North Carolina, and I'm planning to go again this summer. Well, the headline read, "Police remove 6-foot alligator from a store entrance on the North Carolina coast."
Now, what are the, do you know off the top of your head what the laws are on killing alligators in the state of North Carolina?
Can't do it.
Okay.
Can't do it. And
they're a protected species?
Yes. Okay. And they're all over the place. You play golf at many of the 100-some-odd golf courses up and down the Grand Strand area. They're out there. There's even little signs saying, you know,
beware of gators.
Beware of gators. You know, they usually just hang out by the pond. They kind of keep themselves.
Hey, Cam and I, we talk about this. It's kind of like the snake sign around here.
Yeah.
Like, hey, just be advised. Know where
you
are.
Yeah, they're in the neighborhood. This happened in Sunset Beach, North Carolina, where I go on vacation. Police officers at the North Carolina coast had to move a 6-foot alligator away from the front door of a business. The complaint came on Friday afternoon about an alligator at the entrance of Coastal Outfitters located on the mainland at Sunset Beach. Lynn and I shop there.
Maybe we go to Coastal Outfitters. Maybe he needed some board shorts.
You can get them there. And you can get the flip-flops.
Nice pair of sunglasses.
Beach chairs. Standing, and he's just hanging out down there. I mean, that's where it's
nice
one of
a flowered shirt.
You've been to Galveston many times. You've seen Wings. Yeah. The story. Okay. Wings started on the North Carolina coast there in the Myrtle Beach area as what was originally Kings and then Wings. So that's where it is. So they have a Wings in Galveston, and that's what that kind of is. That's what it's a beach store like that.
So he just
and it's
to
a
go,
newer one.
Want to get him a straw hat and some sunglasses and
just hang.
Just make sure he was protected from the sun.
Said when officers arrived, the alligator was concealing himself under several display chairs where the customers enter and exit the business. Man, somebody going, let me see how this chair fits. It sits down and he's under the chair. They had to get him out from under there.
6-foot gator sounds like nothing to be trifled with.
Remember we were talking about jobs, dirty jobs, good jobs, the micro jobs?
Yeah.
One of the officers, Lee Hall, is licensed with the North Carolina Wildlife Resources Commission and is trained and certified to remove nuisance alligators.
Here's my question.
How about that for a job?
So like Texas game wardens, do all game wardens have to be able to, because we have alligators in Texas.
Yes, we do.
Do they have to be trained on how to do that specifically? Is that across the board, like game wardens have to be able to do that?
Well, this dude is licensed and trained and certified to remove nuisance alligators.
That's what I mean. Like, do the game, or does the game warden have to call somebody? Do you have to call the
We got to bring in an expert.
Get the Crocodile Dundee line and call the gator expert.
Well, it says Hall and other officers managed to grab the gator. They put him in the back of a pickup truck and they drove him off. Can you imagine that dude flopping around in the back of your truck? If I put it in the back of my truck from Leif Johnson Ford, I'd be a little bit concerned. Said out of concern for
his nails might scratch the bed.
Yeah. Out of concern for the safety of the business owners, customers, and the alligator, was safely relocated to a nearby pond in Sunset Beach. Says it's a relatively new building. I can tell you how new it is. It's not even quite 4 years old. The first time Linda went to the beach with me in 2019, the store had just opened. She went, oh, I want to go in there. And I was like, okay. So we went in there. It's the first time we went in. So the store's not even 4 years old. That's why it said relatively new. There's a lot of older shops there. Police reminded people that if they spot an alligator potentially endangering people, to call the Sunset Police Department there. So they're all around the area. When I was telling Linda about this, she goes, well, they just let him go in a pond? I'm like, well, yeah, they're protected. So they just go. There's lots of ponds and little inlet areas, and they, like I said, they largely keep to themselves.
So at the risk of offending truck guys, Craig, you're a truck guy. You got that truck from Johnson Ford.
By the way, I saw a record number of trucks in one parking lot yesterday at that speaking engagement.
With a bunch of coaches, who'd have thought?
And insurance agents.
Okay. I've never understood why you buy a truck and the people that get really worried that like the truck bed's going to get scratched. Like, what's the point of owning a truck? You get a truck to in theory, because it helps make stuff easier to move.
You have to use stuff that will, ergo, scratch the bed.
Yeah, I've never understood why I've been around some people that get so offended when the truck, like, don't scratch the bed. I'm like, I'm moving a couch. You think I care about your truck bed right now?
Yeah.
I'm more worried about my back and knees than your truck bed.
All right, I got one more animal story for you. Let me ask our producer, Cameron Parker, a question first. Cam, you're a little bit of a video gamer, aren't you? You're a gamer, aren't you?
Used to be hardcore.
Okay.
Now, less and less.
Some Tiger Woods golf?
Oh, yeah.
Do you have, or did you have at any point, a Nintendo Switch?
No. Okay. I was strictly Xbox 360, Xbox One.
Well, Nintendo Switch now has added a game that apparently was available in the past. This game is called Animal Shelter Simulator. Animal Shelter Simulator. And what it basically is you're running an animal shelter. So what you're trying to do is feed the dogs, and it shows, the simulator shows the somebody cleaning up, like, the dog poop?
Shoveling poop, yeah.
Yeah.
Poop scooping.
This is a game. It's a game.
That sounds like the most boring game ever.
Yeah.
Why would you do that? I have to scoop dog poop in my yard for real. Like, why would I want to do it on a video game?
Yeah. I don't know. Animal Shelter Simulator, and they also have a game called Road Builder that's on Nintendo Switch. But this animal shelter game, I mean, it just shows that people like taking care of dogs.
I wonder if it's from the same developers that make the farming simulator game.
Well, Linda asked me a similar question. She said, you know, that because they also have there's a road builder thing and that deal too. And she asked me a very similar question about that. And I said, well, I can get that, but it says taking care of your four-legged charges and finding the best possible homes for them. And I said, so that's really a game. Taking care of animals, an animal shelter simulator.
That playing that interests me about as much as getting a colonoscopy, and at least the colonoscopy can judge my health, so there's something somewhat rewarding at the end.
Animal shelter. Now, look, I know when I had the original Nintendo, there was a game called Paperboy, and I had it. And folks would say, well, what's the point about that? All you're doing is just delivering
dodge obstacles and stuff.
You have to dodge,
like,
dogs and the lady with the rolling pin.
No, Paperboy was good back in the day.
And you got to land the paper on the board. So there's some dexterity involved with
this
that. This is taking care of dogs, finding good homes, you know? So
see, when I was a kid, all the olds, y'all knocked Mortal Kombat and all the fun games we were playing, and now this is what we have.
Well, that's what Linda said. She said, you know, like when you played Galaga, I'm like, yeah, we're wiping out aliens and saving the galaxy. She said, well, you know, this is, games have changed. I said, clearly, they have.
Trying to defeat Goro, save the world.
Absolutely.
And Shang Tsung taking it over.
Instead,
important
here.
Stuff. Trying now to make I scoop dog crap.
Yeah.
Yeah. No.
Yeah. Yeah. So. Just
be like Scorpion, you hit that toasty move or you burn people, pull your hood off.
Somebody said, is the name of the game called Give Me Shelter? No, it's not.
Finish him.
Not named after the Rolling Stones song. So, yeah, there it is. All right, hour number two of Light the Tower coming up on the Horn. Second hour of Light the Tower on the Horn. Craig Way, Jeff Howe with you. Our producer, Cameron Parker. Glad to be with you here on this Thursday afternoon. Jeff will be out tomorrow. And then I'm going to see you at the ballpark tomorrow night, aren't you? You're going to be there?
Yeah, I'll be there for the Red River. What are we going with? Showdown is showdown. The official.
This is just me, okay? I'm just spitballing here.
Okay. You're the voice of the Longhorns, so make sure you're...
I'm just saying the Red River Showdown thing strikes me differently when it's in the home-and-home setup, like with basketball or baseball. Football, one's crossing the Red River, one's going up toward the Red River, they're both going 200 miles, roughly, they're meeting at a neutral spot.
Just go Red River Series.
Okay. Yeah, that'd be all right. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah,
kind of like our show open, just be generic.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So, that's why it's a little bit different to me in basketball and baseball than football. Football is its own unique environment because of being in the Cotton Bowl at the State Fair of Texas. Our good friend Toby Rowland, the voice of the Sooners, will not be in town this weekend to call the baseball series. Oklahoma spring game this weekend, and they're honoring Kyler Murray.
For what?
For being a Heisman Trophy winning Sooner.
Okay.
Yeah. So he's like back in town for that.
Good for him, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's yeah. So in fact,
don't mean to disparage Kyler, but
no, I'm just saying. They're honoring Kyler Murray with a statue and a banquet.
How many statues they got at that dang place now?
I guess they do one for every
for
Heisman.
For every Heisman winner?
Yeah. So they got one for Kyler. I wonder if it'll actually look like him.
It'll be the shortest of all of them.
Well, if they're going
things to be realistic.
Lifelike, right? Yeah. So if they're going lifelike, you know. On
was Baker's statue the one that just looked kind of weird? Like, I'm thinking about it right. I think Baker had one that I'm like, that doesn't look like
that's
Baker
what I'm
Mayfield.
Saying. There was one of them, I guess it was Baker, the one that didn't look like him at all.
Yeah.
That's why I said, well, they make sure to get it right to where the one for Kyler looks like Kyler. That sort of deal. So.
Yeah, the Baker one's close enough.
Yeah, yeah. They said maybe Kyler should play shortstop, Craig. He was an outfielder when he came down and played baseball here on one of the deal.
I like this from Nate. Kyler reached a Call of Duty level we can only dream of.
Yeah, yeah. There you go.
Got to live up to that contract, Craig.
Yeah. Just
get off the Xbox and get on the film study.
Clean up from hour number one. Jersey guy says, you know, with regard to that story we had about Animal Shelter Simulator, and he said, you know, because it said you try to find them good homes, you take good care of the dogs, and it says, if you cannot adopt out your dogs and puppies, do you have to euthanize them? You know, and I got to admit,
Jeebus.
I got to admit, it kind of crossed my mind. What happens if you're unsuccessful with finding them homes? What happens to them? Hopefully it's a no-kill shelter, because that's what you want. So, you know,
yeah,
on
I
the
guess.
Dog simulator.
Why did that have to take a dark turn?
Yeah. No, not a dark turn. Just, you know, it's consequence of the video game, right? It happens there. Hopefully that's not the case.
Look, man, the only video games I play, let's be honest, I'll fire up the Super Nintendo Classic and I'll go Mario Kart or maybe a little Street Fighter 2.
There you go.
I got to pick E Honda to do the arm thing.
Yeah.
You move the arm really fast.
Yeah. On the Specs text line, someone recently said that Kyler runs like a 2-year-old running with a cell phone. And I can't get that image out of my head. I think, what was it? Is it Bucky that says he has those little mincing steps? I think he described it one time that. Kyler's statue presenting sponsor is Call of Duty, somebody
there
said.
There you go.
Yeah. Baker's statue is of him eating the sidewalk in Arkansas.
That's one that's going to be tough for him to live down.
Yeah, happens there. That's the. I like I says, You said animal shelter simulator. That's what it's called. It's a, so this game is A.S.S. Yeah, I guess so. I guess that would be the case. Somebody else had, resale value on that.
You know, can I just point out something on Twitter that's bothering me?
What's bothering you on Twitter?
Well, there's a lot of stuff on Twitter that's bothering me. By the way, Craig, did you have a blue check mark?
I never did.
I'm supposed to be losing mine today because I'm not paying to use that damn thing. Yeah. And apparently all the legacy check marks that aren't paid for by the day, you're supposed to lose it. So,
oh, really?
I'll pour one out for my blue check mark.
I never had one, so that's okay.
So there's a lot of smoke that Brennan Thompson may be transferring to Oklahoma after, you know, entering himself into the transfer portal. And I just don't understand, like, why it's Oklahoma writers that are doing it. Mm-hmm. I don't understand why they feel the need to, like, go back to Texas through Texas fans' Twitter accounts
and grandstand it.
Find positive Brennan Thompson tweets and then, like, quote tweet, you know, well, you know, Brennan's leaving, but we're really good in the wide receiver room. He would have been sixth or seventh here. And, like, I don't know. I just don't. There's certain media members and certain sections of the media that I'm just like, can you just for 10 minutes, just act like a professional and do your job and not just be a doucher and just act like you have a handle on what you're doing.
Are any of those folks that are doing that, are they ones who work for the same type of agency that you work for?
I'm going to plead the fifth on that.
Uh-huh. Okay. Mm, just wondering just, about that.
Oh my gosh, this makes my head hurt. Yeah. Like, why do you need to get into that with fans? Like, they are the reason why the people, I feel like me and others that do it the right way, they are the reason why we have a hard time asserting ourselves with legacy media.
Yeah, I understand.
Oh, you guys are homers. You guys, well, no, we're not. Well, look at this guy. Well, yeah, it's.
What did you say? Just say legacy.
Legacy media. You know, TV, print, radio. Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. Okay. All right.
Apparently, I was told we're not considered online. We're not considered legacy media.
They said OU athletic department can save money if you just go buy a Dungeons and Dragons miniature for a statue. Okay. About the animal shelter simulator, said there's a power wash simulator game too. It's also a power wash simulator.
Are you kidding me?
I mean,
like, what are we doing here?
Yeah, I sort of say, if I want to change the filter, and I need to do this, change the filters in my air conditioning units in my house, is it going to be a simulated game for that?
You need to do that like every 6 weeks. Right?
I was great with it when I lived in the home in Cedar Park. I did it once a month, like clockwork. And I've been less, part of it is it's a little more difficult to get, but I've been... I haven't been as good at it since we moved into Georgia.
Trey was doing the midday show with Chad, and he's like, oh, I don't think I've ever changed my air filters in my house. I'm like, dude, you need to get on that ASAP.
Yeah, yeah.
You're just asking for a massive heat or AC problem.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Maybe A-plus Air Conditioning and Home Solutions would have to help you out with one of our sponsors of Longhorn Baseball.
Look at you, Craig, getting the plugs in.
Yeah, they are one of our loyal sponsors of Texas Longhorn Baseball.
My brother's an HVAC guy, so I get the lecture. Hey, make sure you're changing your filters. Make sure you change your filters. Yes, I try to do it once a month. We try to do it once a month, change the filters.
Yeah. Somebody said, is Bob Barker in the animal shelter simulating game reminding you to spay or neuter your
population.
Pets?
Have your pet spayed or neutered. Goodbye, everybody.
Yeah. Is that part of the deal? Yeah. How about
that? That's funny. You know, that's usually right around the time that it was time for my grandma to get ready to start going to work was when Bob Barker was reminding you to help control the pet population.
Really? At the end of The Price is Right?
The Price is Right is ending. And
Won the showcase?
As the world turns, Young and the Restless starts.
Yeah.
That's right around the time my grandma starts getting ready to go to work.
Reminder to get your pet spayed and neutered.
Yeah.
Yeah. Someone says Oklahoma is the Gerald of the United States.
That's a great way to put it, yeah.
Okay, I thought you would probably like that. This is yet another sign that we are depriving the kids of the good that comes from manual labor. Yeah, when those things are on the simulated game on that. And Longhorn Lubbock channeling their inner Judge Smales. Hey, guys, the world needs ditch diggers too.
Where do we get on talking about What simulator were you talking about?
Animal shelter, and then the power wash. Yeah, yeah.
Well, just
yeah.
There's nothing wrong with having a job. Excuse me, where you're in charge of power washing things, but do you really need? It's I don't know. It's doing like video games are supposed to allow you to detach from reality.
Yeah.
Simulators of real life tasks.
There's a lawn mowing simulator. There's a lawnmower one.
Like you want to make a good simulator, okay? Make like a garbage man simulator, right? But instead, the garbage man has to complete his route like in the middle of a zombie apocalypse, and you give him like a machete or something, and he's got to collect weapons and you know dispatch zombies to finish his trash route. You want to give me that kind of simulator? Now we'll talk.
Now you're on board.
Now. I'm interested.
Cooter says, if you've ever had to pay to have the coils on your AC unit cleaned, or even worse, if you try to do it yourself, you will always remember to change your filters. It's true. You know, so CB wants to know, Jeff, who's worse, Gerald or Tim Duncan? To yesterday's.
Like which one do I dislike more? Well, I mean, Tim Duncan's better, obviously. Mm. But which one do I dislike more?
Wow. I didn't realize you had such antipathy for the Spurs over Tim Duncan. I mean, I knew you're Houston based.
Well, I think Tim Duncan's a great player, right? I just think prime Kevin Garnett is better than prime Tim Duncan. It's just my personal opinion.
Kevin Durant?
Kevin Garnett. Yeah. And if you want to, even if one of my all-time favorite players, you want to put Dirk Nowitzki in that discussion of the best power forwards ever, yeah, I don't think Dirk gets into that discussion enough. But, like, as far as personally, I just think Tim Duncan's a bad guy.
Why do you say that?
I've never met anybody out in Gen Pop that's told me they've had a positive interaction with him.
I know he did a lot of work in the community and charitable.
Whereas like with David Robinson, I've heard the exact opposite. Great guy.
Yep.
Awesome guy. I don't think I've ever met anybody that's had an interaction with David Robinson that's had anything bad to say about him.
Yeah.
So Different personalities, different upbringings, for sure.
I just don't care for Tim Duncan personally, but I respect the fact that he's a great player.
Grant says, what did Tim Duncan ever do to you, Jeff? Yeah.
Yes, Nate, I see your texts and other of their ilk, and I'm not gonna go there.
Yeah.
I'm not
gonna go there. Thank you.
See it, read you loud and clear, but yeah. just not gonna go there.
Yeah, yeah. All right.
Helios says, Jeff is a trash truck driver. There are plenty of zombies asking us to take more than they pay for. Yeah, that's not fair either. You know, I'll learn that. You know, if you have a bulk pickup, like need a bulk pickup for your trash, if you call whoever your trash provider is ahead of time and tell them I need, like when I lived in Buda and I was getting trash service, like I think I got like two free bulk pickups a year. You just had to call ahead of time. Like, you know, you like leaves or
sure,
you know, wood,
tree branches,
pot,
things like
yeah,
that,
stuff man. Like that. They'll stop and pick it up if you schedule it ahead
bundle
of time.
Bundle properly.
But you just can't. It almost makes you a flawed person if you just throw that stuff on the curb and expect the trash man to pick it up. Yeah.
Totally agree.
Yeah.
Totally agree.
Have some respect for the trash. Or I guess women can pick up trash to the trash person mm-hmm. that's going around collecting. Emptying your receptacle. So have some respect for them. That's a hard job.
Yep.
It's a damn hard job.
Absolutely. So there you go.
Rain or shine, you got to get out there and work, man.
Hillier says, sometimes the way some of these fans defend their player makes me hate the player even more. That's a typical, that's how fans are. Not saying anything negative toward Hillier. I'm just saying that is regular response. You might say call and response, if you will, to how fans love their specific player and then automatically hate a rival team's key player. It's pretty much an established fact that one of the most unpopular basketball players in the Big 12 Conference around the league is Brock Cunningham.
Yeah.
Now, having said that, Longhorn fans absolutely love him. With what he was, because you get a chance to hear from him more and the good guy that he is and how hard he works and all that other kind of stuff. But around the league, people think that, you know, that he's rough and tumble and borderline dirty, if not dirty itself, and so on and so forth. So it's going to be like that when there's somebody. I can remember when Eduardo Nájera played for Oklahoma, I thought, and Renzi Stone. I used to think those were two you know, really just sleazy, rough, and tumbled, dirty players. I got to know Eduardo Nájera later.
Yeah.
He's a very pleasant fellow and all that. And
there, we got a text in all caps that they will not tolerate any Brock Cunningham slander.
Yeah, exactly.
Which, by the way, it's been a minute. Like, because we don't talk a ton of Kyler Murray on the show just because we don't talk a ton of NFL. Man, I forgot, for Texas fans, Kyler Murray's short joke is like throwing, you know, raw meat to like hungry dogs, man. They have pounced on, and we have gotten a flood. I mean, a flood of Kyler Murray short jokes of all types and varieties.
Sure.
In the last 15 minutes.
Oh yeah. It's come in. As a Red Sox fan, someone says it hurt to love Mariano Rivera and Jeter as much as I did. Those guys were filthy. I'm the same way as people know me. I've been a long suffering Dodger fan. When I grew up, I hated the Big Red Machine, but I respected the hell out of Johnny Bench and Pete Rose and Tony Perez and Joe Morgan and Dave Concepcion. Yeah, I can name their starting lineup. Cesar Geronimo, George Foster, Ken Griffey Sr.
Can I just state one thing that I would disagree with Mariano Rivera? Nobody can tell me with a straight face that Mariano Rivera should have been, that a closer, as good as he was, should have been the first unanimous Hall of Famer.
You're saying that he should have been?
Shouldn't have been.
Oh, should not have been. No. Yeah. Well, that a lot of that had to do with there was an old guard of Major League Baseball reporters and writers that bore whatever grudges they had toward given players, which is why Babe Ruth and Ty Cobb weren't unanimous selections.
Like Nolan Ryan wasn't. Like, that's ludicrous.
Willie Mays.
Yeah.
Henry Aaron.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to, if those guys.
Like, could somebody really sit there and say Mickey Mantle's not a Hall of Famer? Like, for real? Like,
Mickey Mantle, just, not unanimous. Yeah, right. Oh, Joe DiMaggio. You can go on and on and on. And Ted Williams, go on and on and on about the great and say not unanimous. I think until Rivera, the guy closest to it was Tom Seaver.
Mm-mm, that'd be George Kenneth Griffey Jr. Was it 99
well,
point something
yeah,
percent?
Yeah, yeah, he passed. You're right. He passed Seaver. Seaver was, I think, had the highest percentage until Junior. And so there's a lot of history and unpleasant. You know,
actually, I didn't know that Jeter had passed Griffey. Jeter
okay,
99.7%.
Yeah, there's another.
Griffey was at 99.32. Yeah. Tom Seaver was at 98.84.
Yeah. So, until Rivera, you know.
Like, just looking at this, I hope whoever, like, didn't vote for Hank Aaron, like, got their vote revoked. Seriously. Like, you can't justify that.
Yeah. Willie Mays, who I think was the greatest all-around baseball player of all time. That's
you
just
go,
my
just go down the list. Someone goes sit there with a straight face and tell me they didn't think Tony Gwynn was a Hall of Famer?
Right. Right.
Other than Ted Williams and Pete Rose, maybe the greatest hitter that ever lived?
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, that
this
that,
is why there's this detachment from the game of baseball that some people have.
Well,
some of it just doesn't make any sense.
And a lot of that stuff, like I said, is pretty deep seated. That goes back on stuff for years. The reason Jim Rice didn't get in was because he was the media hated him because he was so difficult to deal with.
Yeah.
He just was. And so they bore their own grudge toward Jim Rice by leaving him off their Hall of Fame ballot. So,
you know, I know Curt Schilling's a polarizing guy, but
yeah.
I almost respect Curt. I actually do respect Curt Schilling for being like, hey, if you hate me, don't vote for me.
Yeah.
I don't want to be in. Just don't vote for me.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we won't.
Yeah. So there you go. All right. Coming up, we have a Flex 30 update, and we'll have this hour's Longhorn Notebook when we continue to light the tower on the Horn, 104.9, 101.9 AM 1260. We're live, local, and digital on the Horn app at hornfm.com. Our friends at Total Men's Primary Care want you guys to be sure to take care of yourselves. And sometimes a little bit of preventive maintenance can help. like getting that annual physical done. If you're thinking that maybe you might be one of those one out of every three guys at or above the age of 40 who might have low testosterone, why not go and get it checked out? Total Men's Primary Care specializes in treating men with low T. If you've been putting off that conversation for a while about what's been going on down there, Total Men's may have the answer. They're offering a $19 testosterone evaluation at all locations. You don't even have to take my word for it. Just schedule an appointment online at totalmens.com. You'll see the yellow button that says book an appointment. You click on that, and then you can be seen in many cases that very same day at any of their more than 20 greater Austin area locations. See for yourself how Total Men's is redefining the men's health game. Go to totalmens.com. Find the location that's right for you. Total Men's Primary Care. It's the doctor's office just for men. This is Light the Tower on the Horn. Craig and Jeff with you. Producer Cam Parker with us.
Can we just keep this going throughout the segment?
Why not? Yeah. The greatness of the late Tom Petty. I have been hard-pressed to, not that I've ever gone seeking this.
Keep moving on.
You might have be hard-pressed to find someone who disliked his music. I'm not.
Petty?
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever run into anybody that's like, you know who I don't like? Tom Petty.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And I will also.
I'm thinking about it. I don't think there has been.
I will also tell you this. When we all did the music survey, and the return of the music survey is coming this summer, but when we all did the music survey, since we all did it, the most common answer of, I should have had that guy on my list.
That was one of mine, yeah.
Was Tom Petty, including mine as well. I should have included that guy on my list. That was the most common response.
Rest
on
in
that.
Peace, Tom Petty.
Indeed.
Was that the Patriots Giants Super Bowl where
we lost him?
They did the halftime show.
Yes.
The one in Phoenix?
Yes.
Yeah. That's what I thought.
Yes. Okay. How about a Flex 30 update?
Flex ATX for the best high school sports coverage. Listen to the Horn and go to FLXATX.com. Flex 30 is brought to you by Brain Vault. Brain Vault is a revolutionary and patented mouthguard that has been proven to help reduce the risk of concussion. Visit BrainVault.com and join the movement.
That was Super Bowl 42, by the way. Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers were the halftime show.
Well done. The most recent Texas high school baseball top 25 rankings out for this week. And the area is well represented. Cameron Parker, care to give us any guesses on it? First of all, do you know who's number one in the state? In 6A?
It's Westlake.
In 6A?
It's Westlake.
It is not Westlake.
Fort Bend Elkins.
No, but
For years that would have been the right answer.
Yeah. But James Loney there playing for them. Fort Bend Ridgepoint is number 9. Westlake's number 3.
Wardell Starling.
Yeah. Number 1 team in the state is Cy Woods.
Okay.
Out of the greater Houston area, 23-3. San Antonio Johnson, number 2. Westlake, 3. Flower Mound, 4. San Antonio Reagan, the home of Travis Daly and Porter Brown, an annual contender. Number 5, Pearland 6, Lake Travis is 7. And the team for whom Cameron Parker serves as their play-by-play voice, Round Rock, the Dragons, number 8 in the state.
There we go.
Fort Bend Ridge, point 9, and Rockwall is 10. And Rockwall Heath is 11, by the way. 10 and 11, those arch rivals there. That is in 6A.
Is Lifetime Longhorn Danny Wallace still the
yes,
head coach
he is.
Of Flower Mound?
He certainly is. They're number 4 in the state.
Correct me if I'm wrong. Wasn't Austin Wallace in that Madden tournament that you called?
He was.
Yeah.
He won the UT
That's
campus
what I thought. Yeah.
Competition and then was dismissed in the quarterfinals by John Haycock's son, who is about to be a GA there.
Maybe Jace Haycock is the one who helped his dad come up with that 3 safety defense.
Could have been. You know, the little cloud coverage
it was
there.
Right under our noses the whole time.
Yeah. Flower Mound High is number 4 there. South Lake Carroll, the defending state champions, lost twice in district play last week, and they dropped the number 21 there in that. In 5A, your 5A rankings. Friendswood number one in the state. And then how about Rouse at number seven? Raiders at 18-4-1. And Liberty Hill, competing as a 5A program now, of course, in at number 22. They are 19-5, are the Panthers there. 4A in the top 25 rankings. Sinton, Adrian Alanese's team, of course, they graduate Rylan Galvan, and they just move right along. They're 25-1 are the Pirates, defending state champs, number one in the state. And no area schools in the 4A state rankings. Closest one, I guess, would be Bernie at 23-3. They are number four in that. 3A, top 25, Corpus Christi London, which has really established itself as one of the top teams in that classification year in, year out. How about your state football champions from Franklin, number two in baseball, 22-1-1 are the Lions there. And Gunner, and it's a lot of the same suspects, Brock, Gunner, Wall, all of them in the top 10.
One thing you notice with the smaller schools, typically the doubles where they're really good are going to be football and baseball. Mm-hmm. And it's not that they're not good at basketball. It's just by the time they're done with football, basketball's halfway over.
You're right. They wind up, you have teams that and sometimes that, will reach the state tournament. Yeah. They've played 17, 18 games.
And then at that point, it's like, well, you know, just go ahead and start getting ready for baseball.
Yeah. Closest one, Jeff, to the greater Austin area. Well, Lorena is in there too, but also Little River Academy in the 3A. State rankings,
the bees.
16-6-1. They are number 16. Lorena is number 13 on that. Troy, number 11. So you got some I-35 corridor
Trojans
there. And by the way, number four in the state is Central Heights. Now, you know where Central Heights is?
Nacogdoches.
Yeah. You know who the one of the recent outstanding players to come from Central Heights?
I'm going to be mad at myself.
I know you are. I know. How about Duke Ellis?
That's right. Yeah. Yes.
Longhorn center fielder.
I went to junior college.
Yes, at Panola.
In Texas.
There in Carthage. And then in 2A, in your top 25, you had, like you said, the football baseball double, Shiner. Number one. So, of course, Shiner's been great in baseball for years, even when they were not so much in football. They've had outstanding baseball for years and years and years there in 2A. I'm looking to see. I do not see. Closest one, Jeff, Johnson City.
It's right down the road.
Yeah, number 16. So that'd be the close up. Flatonia is number 12. So you've got a couple there. So there it is.
By the way, Duke Ellis in Double A with the White Sox.
There you go. Holland Hornets, number 24. There.
A lot of places I've been to, Craig.
I know. That's why I brought that up. All right. So there it is. There's your Flex 30 update. Your updated top 25 state baseball rankings. Let's move forward to our hourly edition of the Longhorn Notebook.
Jeff Howe's Longhorn Notebook.
Yeah, I just posted this update at Horns 24/7, and I'll give it to you right now. Just a quick Max Asmus visit update. He was at the baseball game last night. That was part of the first day of the visit. And again, Rodney Terry couldn't have picked a better night to throw a really good first pitch. Got to hang out last night. Got at breakfast with the staff this morning. Then they were going to do a campus tour. Everything I've heard from multiple people at this point is there is confidence growing that Texas, their chances are going to be really good to get Max Asmus. Again, you know, him going to Manhattan, going to Kansas State, and leaving that trip uncommitted. And I heard Craig Jerome Tang was pushing very, very hard to get that thing
done.
Try
to get him to commit.
While he was up there. He leaves uncommitted. And then now Texas, as far as I know, I don't, other than Wichita State, I haven't really heard of any other schools being involved. I know there was some Baylor chatter at one point in time, but I think with Jacoby Walter coming in and them getting Jaden Nunn, I don't know that it's hard to say you don't have room for a player like Max Asmus because you do, but, you know, they've got one of the guards they wanted, in Texas. You know, I said this morning with Bucky and Aaron, Max Asmus is the kind of guy, if he comes to Texas, he steps in day one and is the face of your program. He's the franchise. He is the guy that you build around. And I think he's got the type of presence that guys would want to come play with him, whether you're talking about one-year guys, two-year guys, whatever. Guys would want to come to Texas to play with Max Asmus, because if you could put you know, legitimate high major Division I talent around him. Now you're talking about a team that can go compete in the Big 12. And you know, if you can compete in the Big 12, you can compete in the NCAA tournament. Mm-hmm. And if you just get to the second weekend and give yourself a chance, you may be able to make it to Monday night. And he's the kind of guy that can help you get over the hump. So if Texas can close this deal and get Max Asemus, that I think that should make a lot of Texas fans feel better about what Rodney Terry's doing in the portal.
Yeah. Yeah. Agreed. I agree with you there. And also with the possibility of what he can bring to a program, mm-hmm, with his skill set, with his experience, all of those things.
And then I think for the staff, you know, I think best case scenario for them, get Max Asemus, continue to chip away on Caden Shedrick, and then really kind of evaluate that, because you're pretty much getting to the end of the first wave of portal guys. Then you start to evaluate that second wave, the guys that have gone in the last week or so that you've had contact with. Now you can really start to figure out. But hopefully by that point, you've got a decision from Dylan DeSue. If you've got a good feel for what you think Tyrese Hunter and Dylan Mitchell are going to do, now you've got a really good idea of, okay, here's how many spots we have. Here's where we need to fill it. Now you can get into that second wave of portal guys. At least you've made contact with. At least they know who you are. They're familiar with you. Now you can prioritize guys and go attack that second wave.
There you go. Our good friend Jim Matthews said, don't forget about George Foster and those red starters. Did I not say? I thought I said it. If I said it, I said it really quickly. You know, George Foster in left, Cesar Geronimo in center, Ken Griffey Sr. in right, and then, you know, going around the diamond, you'd have Pete Rose. Of course, Pete played outfield. He played first base. He played third base. However, it had to work for them on a given night on the lineup. Dave Concepcion at short, Joe Morgan at second. And then, like I said, it would quite often be him at first. You'd have Dan Dreesen coming off the bench there, Johnny Bench behind the plate. And they had outstanding pitchers. You know, you had Jack Bellingham, and you had Don Gullett before his injuries. He had several really good. That big red machine was something else.
Hey, speaking of baseball from that era, shout out to Walt and the folks at Card Traders of Austin. They send their best to you.
All right,
picked up didn't mean to go in there and buy anything, but got a really good deal on an Emmett Smith Score rookie.
So you've said this so many times in your life. Didn't mean to go in there and buy anything, but.
One time it was a Ricky Henderson rookie. I'm like, for that price, I can't pass it up.
Sure,
really good price they got over there. Still working on your request.
Okay.
Walt is on the hunt, but okay. still trying to make that happen.
All right. If it comes up, that's great. I'm quite interested on that. Somebody else pointed out, hey, Duke Ellis, his dad was also drafted by the White Sox. That's a cool story.
I guess it's the same texter asking if Kobe Minchie was related to Nate Minchie.
Yeah, his son.
I mean, I guess if they're father and son, I guess you could say they're related.
Yes, he is. Nate, of course, graduate of Pflugerville High and was in pro ball close to two decades. A lot of it spent in the Pacific Rim in Japan. That's where Kobe was born, but also spent time in the bigs.
Okay, can I tell you something about Japanese Baseball League real quick that I didn't know?
Yeah,
I didn't know this until like a year ago. So, you know the Nippon Ham Fighters?
Sure.
I didn't know that Nippon Ham was a company that sponsored the team.
Yes.
I just thought like they were from Nippon and they were called
the Ham Fighters.
Yeah, I'm like, wow, it's so cool. But like, oh no, so it's like a sponsorship deal where it's Nippon Ham and they're just called the Fighters. That's not nearly as cool as if you were the Ham Fighters.
Okay.
I legit didn't know that until about a year ago.
Whenever I'm in a supermarket and I see the Yakult yogurt, I think of the Yakult Swallows, you know, the Japanese
league.
That's,
could have picked a better mascot, but
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they went with the Swallows.
Just march forward nonetheless.
There you go. We'll be back to wrap up today's edition of Light the Tower on the Horn.
You know, Cam and I were just talking about one of my all-time favorite movies. And whether it's one of my favorite movies, a ball game, a TV show, when I watch TV, I'm watching it in style thanks to Audio Visual Consultations. If you want the greatest home entertainment setup you ever thought possible, don't delay. Just call Tom McKay right now, 512-255-8678. That's 255-8678. 8678. When I made that call, I didn't know how bad I had it until now I see how good I have it. I'm watching everything on a 75-inch LG TV. I hear it. Crystal clear sound with the Sonos sound system. AV consultations keeps the latest smart TVs and Sonos audio in stock. And whatever they don't have in stock, they can order it for you. Tom McKay gets on the phone. Boom. It's in his hands. Lightning fast, and he can get it done for you. Whatever your needs are, big or small, let them take all the worry out of it. They put together a project that not only makes sense for your budget, it makes sense for the amount of space you've got available. So if you want that same setup like I've got, if you can fit that in your house, obviously they can make that work. If you need something smaller, it's no problem. They can help you out with that too. Or if you've got enough room in your house to get you the full tilt home theater experience, you want that screen that's 150 inches, they can make that happen too. Whatever you want, don't delay. Just call right now and let Tom McKay at AV Consultations handle it. 512-255-8678. That's 255-8678. Let Tom McKay and Audiovisual Consultations help you realize the home entertainment setup of your dreams.
That's going to wrap it for today's program. And tomorrow, we'll talk some Major League Baseball preview, big preview of the weekend of college baseball, not just with Texas, but with the Big 12 Conference and nationally as well. We'll do that. NBA playoffs to get to. There's a lot to get to tomorrow on the program. We invite you to stay tuned. Chad and Zay coming up next for our producer, man behind the glass, Cameron Parker. And for my co-host, Jeff Howell, I'm Craig White. Thanks for joining us. We'll visit with you tomorrow morning, 10 o'clock on Light the Tower.